The Lizard Man campaign is currently out. We're going to watch the video and I'll be commentating as we go through it. I'll be pausing where I need to if I want to go over a few things. And here we go.
Hello and welcome to the latest Total War Warhammer 2 campaign walkthrough. Today we're playing as the Lizardmen faction of Hexawattle, led by the ancient Slan mage priest Mazda Mundi. We're 79 turns into this campaign, and as you can see from the overview map, we've been steadily expanding throughout Lustria. Using the overlays, you can see we've got a great relationship with our neighbours Zlan Huapek, and we are in reasonable stead with Teclis and his Elven Order of Lawmasters, though the Public Order overlay here shows we've got some issues to keep an eye on in our newly annexed territory north and south. Down to ground level, and we can see Mazda Mundi himself mounted on his faithful Stegodon steed Zlak, standing guards at the gates to his capital city. At level 26, he's pretty well equipped already and has earned a number of bonus effects through the new trait system, which now enables lords to level up in a variety of different areas as they successfully or unsuccessfully engage in certain actions. Looking at Mazda Mundi's skills panel, we can also see he's a powerful spellcaster with a selection of some of the more useful and powerful spells from multiple different lores. Further improving his magical abilities is this unique skill chain, which enables him to better harness the winds of magic.
Real quick, just what I want to go over right now. Let's go ahead and look at some of the stats here. We've got a range of 90, a missile damage of 49, and poison damage, a melee attack of 37. But really the big strength here would be through all the magic. I do like that they're adding in a lot more variety to the skill trees. One thing that I did not really like was that you didn't really have enough levels to fully explore a skill tree. And for some of them, you just didn't really have a lot of interesting abilities. So at least here, we've got a lot of very interesting things here that we can use in combat. Like over here, Focus of Mysteries.
And culminates in two powerful bound spells, Focus of Mysteries and the devastating triple wind spell Ruination of Cities, which we will unlock now. A feature unique to the Lizardmen is their ability to tap the Geomantic Web, an ancient nexus of mystical power lines. Settlements can be upgraded to take advantage of this and power up their provincial commandments. You can see that all settlements are connected on the web, which is color-coded to denote the strength of their connection. Hovering over the active provincial commandment, we can see this province is working at strength level 3, giving us a commensurate suite of bonuses to our current commandment or any others that we choose to enact. Now, this geomantic strength is dictated by two things: the geomantic pylon building chain level, and the fact that an adjacent settlement on the web needs to be operating at the same level. Hexawattle's connection here is pulsing because its access to the web is more advanced than that of adjacent settlements, and its commandments can theoretically be operating at a higher level than they currently are. But right now, it's being held back, so if we upgrade the pylon chain in Skeggy here, we will in due course have access to Strength 4 commandments.
Real quick, one thing that I'm really beginning to notice is how much gold that you're able to utilize in this campaign. I really feel like there's going to be a focus on just a massive amount of armies that you're able to utilize in the campaign, which definitely does have a more Warhammer feel. As I've been playing older Total War games, I've been having the capability to really engage in much larger battles because we just have a larger amount of armies on the field. So that's going to be pretty interesting to see what type of fights that we're going to have. And I wonder if the AI will be a little bit more aggressive. I'm definitely digging the, again, uniqueness and complexity that's being added to each faction. So here you have what is essentially a ley line, which is a very common trope in a lot of fantasy settings for our Mesoamerican Lizardmen in particular. It's a pretty interesting type of addition. Anyway, let's go on.
The other playable races, Lizardmen get four unique rites they can perform. If you wish to awaken a powerful Slan to lead one of your armies, then here's how you add him to your recruitment pool. All rites have unlock requirements marked in red here, and timed effect rites have both a duration and a cooldown period. The Rite of Primeval Glory here grants all our forces an army ability, enabling them to summon units of Feral Cold Ones directly into the heat of battle for the next 15 turns. Now, army abilities are granted in a whole variety of ways. For example, because Mazda Mundi is currently stationed near Hexawattle, he's granted the Geomantic Nexus ability, enabling him to summon a Skink Priest spellcaster directly into battle. And it's the city itself and his adjacency to it that provides this particular ability. Taking a look at the Lizardmen building browser, you can see a relatively straightforward selection of building chains, granting resource boosts, civic improvements, and recruitment of the various unit types, characters, and monsters in the Lizardmen roster. As a legendary city, Hexwattle has some unique landmark building options too, granting some very powerful bonuses when the settlement...
Okay, that's pretty... I didn't know how much they would do or how they would do with the building chains and all of that. So it does look like they're trying to add in more to where you're not having to copy-paste building chains in each area. I think eventually it'll get to a point where you still have to continue building the same repetitious things in each town. I mean, that's usually how it's gone so far. But if we have more major towns and more unique buildings, that will at least change it up. And I'm hoping that when we conquer other locations, we'll get a few more landmark buildings, if that's the actual terminology that they would like to use for that.
Reaches level 5. The Lizardmen are also a very enlightened race, so it's no surprise to see an orderly and feature-packed tech tree here, offering improvements to pretty much every aspect of their military and civic matters. The second half and the final tier of this tree are gated behind single techs, which are unlocked by owning specific buildings, which in this particular case we have. The Lizardmen also have access to unique recruitment options called Blessed Spawnings. Blessed units are effectively elite versions of existing units and become available by completing missions which the game will directly issue you. Blessed variants come with improved stats and bonus abilities. You can discern the difference via colouring and other markings. Here are some standard Saurus Warriors and some Blessed Saurus Warriors to their right, who benefit from better stats across the board and the perfect Vigor trait so they never run out of puff in battle. The Blessed Carnosaur is a truly nasty piece of work as it moves 25% faster than a regular Carnosaur and gets a whopping 50% magic resistance buff. Up north now and guarding our toehold in Naggaroth is the Saurus Oldblood Aldo Morin and his army. To help him do this, we're going to place him in the Astromancy stance. This stance is unique to the Lizardmen and is excellent for defense and surveillance. Alongside granting Vanguard deployment to key units in the army, it brings a massive bonus to campaign line of sight and boosts the army's ambush and underway interception chance. So looking at the big picture, we're making okay progress towards ultimate control of the Vortex in this playthrough, though we're lagging a little behind the other races. We're level pegging with Lothurn in terms of how much ritual powering resource we've gathered, though they've just finished their second ritual, and we have yet to begin ours. We can also see that Naggarond and Clan Mors already have their second ritual in progress. So we've already captured and conquered the Mirror Pool of Tepok, which is a ritual resource-bearing settlement. This provides a turn-by-turn drip feed of ancient plaques, the currency the Lizardmen require to empower their rituals. Now, it's wise to capture such settlements and build up the Trove chain as soon as you can, as the ritual income this gives you can make a massive difference over the course of your campaign. Another such resource site is located to our south, but it's owned by our friends, the Lizardmen faction of Zlanhuapek. Fortunately, we spent quite a lot of the game buttering them up to the point where they love us to bits, and we are just about ready to make an offer of confederacy. Okay, good stuff. We're now another stage along Mazdamundi's quest chain for his Cobra Mace, which is a superb legendary item that, among other things, grants him poison attacks. So, Confederation was successful and our tribes have merged. We've inherited the ritual resource site we wanted, along with all their other holdings. But don't forget that when you confederate, you can inherit certain problems as well. We're nestled up against the Vampire Coast with its ever-present threats of creeping corruption, and just to the south of our new territory is a suspiciously large amount of ruins.
Real quick, I just want to go over the fact that he did mention the Vampire Coast. I would like to think that maybe that means that we will in fact have a DLC where we can actually have vampire pirates. I mean, that's really what I want, undead vampire pirates and whatever else. And I know there is a Norse tribe out here too, so... Again, there's a lot of complexity and a lot of factions that could be added in. They're not really on the same scale and tier as the current factions in the game, so I wonder how they will be incorporated. And I wonder if they will be in the Vortex campaign or just added to the Grand campaign. That's a question that I do not know the answer to just yet.
Sure enough, Skaven corruption is rife in this area. Plus, given the name of this particular resource site, I think it's safe to assume these ruins are going to be rat-infested undercities. Fortunately, you can use your hero characters to poke their snouts into ruins and check for infestations. Bokzar here is one of our skink chiefs, and he's out exploring for us, so let's send him in to do some detective work. And sure enough, it turns out that this is Clan Pestilin's country. With such a tiny garrison, the settlement is likely quite underdeveloped, but given the mass of ruins to the southwest, it feels like we'll be butting heads with Lord Skrulk and his pox-ridden swarms in due course. Alright, time to kick off Ritual 2 and get back in the race for the Vortex.
Let's go look at that real quick. On its ritual's completion, a great cosmos engine shall be activated. A machina can channel geomantic thermals to shore up the great warding. Much rumination is needed on how to start such a device. Beginning this ritual will instantly provide the following reward. Right, treasure goes up by 5,000. Alright, here we go.
The ritual panel gives you a heads up as to which three settlements will become entwined with the vortex for the ritual's 10-turn duration. In this case, it's Hexawattl and two of our new acquisitions down south.
The ritual is underway, my lord. Even working together, it will take your greatest adepts some time to complete. Such is the ritual's power that the great vortex itself distorts under its pull. Be wary, though, for while the vortex is weakened, the forces of chaos will slip into this world. Ready your defenses, for they will doubtless be drawn to the ritual's power.
Okay, so we've got three Chaos armies storming towards our southernmost settlements, and we are militarily weak there. Now, this is exactly the kind of pace change that the whole ritual mechanic injects into your campaign. One minute you can be idly considering when you might go to war with some Skaven, the next you've got a considerable force beating down your door, and the clock is ticking. We can also interfere with other races' rituals too by deploying Fire and Forget intervention armies. Opening the interventions panel here shows us our options, and we can see that the Skaven and Naggarond are both nearing the end of their second rituals. Bigger armies cost more, of course, so let's fire off a desperate intervention against the Skaven.
So I wonder if they can do that to you and how annoying that would be, though, if they just kind of constantly do that. I'm sure there's a cooldown for that. So yeah, again, that's a change up to the gameplay. You're not just kind of focused on conquering lands, and that's a unique feature of the Eye of the Vortex campaign.
Checking the overview map, we now have a line of sight in Clan Moore's territory where our intervention army has appeared. These armies are AI controlled, and they have a single purpose, to conquer and raise the target ritual settlement. And quite the army it is, with lots of high tier units on board. And with luck, it'll take out that settlement during the end turn cycle and scupper their ritual. And on that cliffhanger, we'll leave Mazdamundi to his conundrums. Do follow us on social and keep an eye on our YouTube channel for a close-up look at the Lizardmen in battle coming very soon.
Okay. That was really cool. There's a lot of information there. I don't know who actually did the narration and who did the video, but hey, great job. That was actually a great explanation of all the mechanics of what was going on. We saw just a lot of things that are going to add a lot of complexity. Again, I just wonder what it's actually going to be like when I'm able to play it and what it'll feel like as we go on through the campaign. I mean, that's a big question. We're seeing like little snapshots, but I wonder how it'll actually feel. But again, I just want to focus on the fact that gold doesn't seem to play as much of an important part as it did for previous campaigns, where it just felt like you had to balance a fine thread in order to do anything at all. At least here, it feels a little bit more sensational, where you're able to have just massive armies. You're able to send out armies to go fight. I wonder if the AI is going to be able to properly respond to intervention forces. I'm assuming that that has been play tested and that they will be able to actually respond to that, or they'll try or potentially have some type of priority to defend locations for a ritual. Like here, the player was a little bit undefended down south, whereas I'm hoping the AI will actually have a larger garrison and army to defend and all of that. So if there's anything that you want me to cover or go over, let me know about that. Hopefully I'll be getting access to Warhammer 2 soon. I do not have it yet, and that'll be a lot of fun whenever I'm able to play that. I want to make sure that I know the game very well. I don't want to be forced to play it last minute and not know the game very well as I get into it. So hopefully I'll get it soon to where I'll be able to really understand things and explain things. My first campaigns will probably be not tutorial based, but I will go over a lot of basic hotkeys. I will go over just all the basic stuff for people who might be newer to the game. A lot of tips and tricks and all of that to get you into a setting and into the gameplay itself. Anyway, thank you for watching. Look forward to more videos in the future, and do check out my Twitch down below. And as always, until then.